Hello all, my name is Balaji and welcome to my YouTube channel. In this video, I'm going to show you how to do gender classification using Python. So we'll do a gender classification on the real-time camera. But before going into the video, let me show you a quick demo on the final product. So you can see my face now with the label of man at the top and 100% accuracy. So this is what we are going to do. And let me take my phone. And I have Aishwarya Rai's photo here, and you can see woman at the top of her face with 100% accuracy. Like, you can have a closer look, so both the faces can also be at the same time viewed in this. So I'll be showing you completely from step by step, and if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, just do it. And with that said, let's get started. Let us now take a look at the dataset. You can download this dataset from my GitHub repository. I have left the link in the description. And let us go into the dataset folder. You can see two folders here, man and woman. Inside man, there will be pictures of men. And around there are 1173 images of men. So these images I took from Kaggle and Google Images. You can also add additional pictures if you want. And there is also this woman folder inside which there are the pictures of women. So women, there are also 1100 images approximately. So this is our data set, and with this data set we are going to create a model to predict whether the given image is a man or a woman. We will now pre-process the data. So in the data pre-processing part, what we are going to do is that we are going to convert all the images into arrays. So create a file called train.py, and this is my train.py file, and these are our imports. I'll explain you the imports as we go through the code. So first thing is, we just create two lists here. One is the data list, and the next one is the labels list. So as soon as we create the data and the labels list, the ultimate aim for us is to append all our images into this data list and append all those corresponding images labels. Say for example, if the particular image is man, then we are going to append the man label here. If the particular image is woman, then we are going to append the woman label to this particular labels. So that is why we created this data and labels list. Right now it is empty. We are going to process this. So I'm using glob here. So glob is nothing but glob gives you the path very easily. So at the moment, all my images are present in the C drive under files and under the gender dataset phase. And I have given the regular expression kind of a thing inside this glob. What this does is, the single slash first gives us the folder name, which is the man or the woman. And then the next slash gives us the image. So the star indicates match anything that you see. So with this, we are just having a list comprehension that saves all the image path inside this particular image files. So I'm doing shuffle here. So shuffle is done because when this glob.glob is done, so it will take all the parts of man first and then it will go for women. So when we kind of train our model, so this model will learn man completely in the beginning, and then it will try to learn woman. So at that time, the weights will be completely changing for women, and at the end, we won't be getting a ideal model. So in order to get an ideal model, we need to have a mix of the data set. So there should be a man, and then there should be a woman, and then there should be a man. So the data set should be mixed well, so that the weights are updated uniformly. So that is the reason we are going for random dot shuffle. So once we shuffle our images, then what we do is, we need to loop through the image files. So image files, as we said, contains all the path to the images of man and women. So we are going to use CV2, and using the imread, and we are going to give the particular path of the image, and this imread file actually reads the image and converts that image into an array. And what we need to do is, we are going to resize the image. So why we need to resize is that whenever we feed something into our model, all the images should be of uniform size. If the images are of varying size, then we will not be getting a good model. So we need to give a uniform size to our images. So in order to do that, I have initially gave image dimensions to be 96, 96 and 3. So 96 is nothing but the height, this 96 is the width, and this 3 is the number of channels. So what you need to know is that every image that we look into is made up of 3 channels, say the red channel, the blue channel and the green channel. So that is why we say RGB, red, green and blue. So I'm going to resize all those images uniformly into 96 by 96. This image is nothing but this is the array that I'm going to resize. So in this image array, I'm going to resize in the shape of 96 by 96. So that is why I gave the indexes here. So image dimensions is here. So 0th index is 96, and again image dimensions of 1 is again 96. So that is 96 by 96. And then what I'm going to do is, as I said before, inside my data list, I'm going to append the particular array. Now, once we got the images into arrays, the next step is to convert the labels. So labels is nothing but we need to kind of separate from the path that we have. For example, this is the path that we have. This particular img is the path that we have, which kind of looks like this. So inside the C drive, under files, under gender dataset, there is women, and then there is the particular image file path. But what we need to do is we need to particularly target whether that is a women or not. So in order to do that, os.path.separation helps us. So this is the index that is given, which is -2, which means this is when separated, this becomes a separate path and this becomes a separate path. So every separation is made wherever there is a backslash. So in that way, we'll pick only the women. So that is why we gave indexes -2. So this is like index coming from the reverse. So if the label is women, then we'll give the label to be as 1, and else if the label is man, then we'll give the label as 0. And we are appending this particular label inside our labels list. So this labels list, we are appending our particular label as 1 or 0. But keep in mind that we are appending it as a list here. So this will be generated like this. So list containing list of whether that is a man or woman. So if it is a woman, we give 1 here, and if it is a man, we give 0 here. And once that is done, we need to convert the data and labels into arrays. Currently, as you see, the data and labels will be list, but for a deep learning processing, we need to convert this into arrays. So in order to do that, we'll use a NumPy, so np.array, and then we need to pass in the particular list which we want to convert that into an array as. So we are using the data here, which is the list that we need to convert into an array, and the data type should be float. So feature scaling is what we are dividing by 255. So why we are dividing by 255 is that every image that you see will have pixel values from 1 to 255. So when we deal with larger values, the computation power required will be high. So if we uniformly divide it by 255, then every value in our image will be from 0 to 1, since the highest value is 255. And similarly, I'll also convert my labels into array. So now both our data and labels are converted successfully into arrays. Once that is done, we need to use our test and train split from sklearn to split the testing and the training data. So we have given test size to be 0.2, which means we gave 20% to be for the testing purpose, and 80% of the data will be for the training purpose. So we are converting the data and labels into trainx, testx, and train y and test y. So once that is done, we are converting the y value specifically. We are not bothered about the data value, which is the images, but we are converting the train y and test y, which is the actually labels. We are converting that into two categorical. So currently we have something like this. We have an array inside which there is either 1 or 0, indicating whether that is a male or a female. But two categorical gives us a two dimensional kind of value, like inside this particular array it will be 1, 0, and again it will be 0, 1. So in this case it is man and it is woman, man, woman. So whatever the value is, that value will be 1 and the other value will be 0. So just it converts kind of a binary form. So if that is a man, the first index will be 1. If that is a woman, the second index will be 1. So that is what two categorical does. So we do this just because we'll have two neurons in our final output layer, and converting this into this step will be easier for us to process at the end. And the other thing that we are going to do is we are going to use image data generator. So image data generator is basically used whenever you have a lesser number of images in your data set. Image data generator kind of creates a lot of images with a single image by changing some of its properties like angle and rotation and flipping, so that we generate many images, and I just save it into an object called AUG. So that is about our data pre-processing part. Let us now get into the modeling section. First, we'll define a function called build, inside which we'll create our model. So this build function actually takes in four arguments. So first is the width, height, depth, and classes. So width is nothing but the width of our image, which is 96 that we gave before, right? So that is the width that we are going to use. And height is nothing but the height of the image, which is again 96. And depth is nothing but the three channels, RGB. And classes is nothing but number of categories that we have in our use case. So in this case, the classes will be two because our categories are man and woman. And the next thing is we'll create a model object from sequential. So sequential is something that comes from here. So from keras.models, we get sequential, and that is what we use here. And the input shape that we generally have is height, width, and depth. So usually keep our channels at last, but at times the model may keep this channels at first. So in order to avoid that, we'll be using change dimensions. So this change dimension is particularly used in normalizing. Normalizing is done to keep values in the data set to a common scale. So batch normalization is usually done to keep the mean activation close to zero and the standard deviation close to one. In that way, we'll have our values in a common scale so that the weights are updated properly. So one thing that we need to do is we need to check whether the channels are first or the channels are last. In order to do that, we'll use this keras.backend, and there is a function called image data format. So this image data format gives back a string saying whether the channels are at first or the channels are at last. So if the channels are first, then we change the dimension to 1, which we will be using in our batch normalization. If the channels are at last, then it will be minus 1 itself. So this is something that we need to keep a note of. So once that is done, we'll add our convolution layer, and we'll keep 32 filters for the convolution layer. And the convoluted image is of the size 3x3. We have given padding, and the input shape that we are going to pass is the input shape, which we defined here, the height, width, and the depth, which in our case will be 96x96x3. And we pass in the ReLU function since we are dealing with the non-linear function, and we do the batch normalization here. Usually after this convolution layer, we do the batch normalization after the activation function. So basically this batch normalization, as we discussed before, helps in normalizing the values. And if we don't normalize, some data points may have a very high value and some may have a very less value, and the higher values may overshadow the lesser values. So batch normalization is kind of important. But batch normalization is not important in all the use cases. It depends on the type of the product that you develop. And once the convolution is applied, we'll apply the max pooling. So max pooling is generally applied to reduce noise in our data set. So noise is nothing but if you have some unwanted dots or something when the image is convoluted, this max pooling kind of looks into the features that is important for us, and it kind of removes the other noise. For example, if a man is there, he may have a beard or a mustache, which is the major features that we look for, and the other potential noises from the data set, such as unwanted dots or pimples or something, will be removed in this max pooling. So that is why we use max pooling. And then we use dropout. So dropout is nothing but say, for example, if we have like 100 neurons in a dense layer, every time these neurons will learn well from the data that is flowing through. When we do not have this dropout, this becomes an overfitting model which understands the training data set very well, but it fails to understand any data set that is outside from our training data set. So in order to avoid that, what we'll do is we'll add this dropout of 0.25, which means 25% of the neurons will be deactivated every time during the front propagation and the back propagation. So in that way, what happens, our model will not have a overfitting problem. So we again give the convolution layers, and again we kind of give a max pooling layer. So we develop our model which with a bunch of convolution and max pooling layers. Now once that is done, we are going to flatten our layers. So till now it will be, the convolution and max pooling will be two dimensional, but in order to feed into our dense layer, these values should be in a single dimension. So that's why we use flatten. So flatten kind of converts all the two dimensions into a single dimension, and then we'll add a dense layer with 1024 neurons, and we'll give the activation function as ReLU. The ReLU is usually the go-to activation function when it comes to image classification. And again, we'll do the batch normalization, and in the dense layer, we are giving dropout as 0.5. So as I said, 50% of the neurons will be deactivated randomly when during the front and back propagation to avoid the overfitting. And finally, we add the classes. So classes, as we saw, will be two here. So that is why we gave the parameter up above. So classes will be two, and finally we apply the sigmoid activation function. In the previous layer we added ReLU, and in the output layer we added sigmoid. Whenever you come to the output layer, the type of activation function that you need to use is either sigmoid or softmax, because they are probability based activation functions and they give values from 0 to 1 on, and finally we return our model. So once we define this function, now we'll call this function. So this is the build function that we have. Now we are going to call the function that we defined. So we are calling the build function with width is equal to image dimensions of 0. Image dimension is something that we gave in the beginning here. So image dimension, as we discussed, is 96 by 96 by 3. And the width is nothing but 96, which is the image dimension of 0. And height, the second parameter that we defined in the build function, is again 96. And depth is nothing but, as I said, the three channels, and the classes is 2. Classes is 2 because in our use case, the output that we are going to get is either man or woman. So now we got our model here, and we'll now define the optimizer. So for the optimizer, we are using the Adam optimizer, and we are passing the learning rate and the number of epochs here. The learning rate and number of epochs have been defined earlier. So epochs is 100 and the learning rate is 1e to the power of minus 3. We have given the batch size to be 64. But actually you can play around with all these values. So once that is done, we now compile our model. So in order to compile the model, we use the binary cross entropy loss function, and for the optimizer we use Adam. So optimizer is nothing but during the back propagation, how the weight should be updated will be taken care of this particular optimizer, and we are going to track the accuracy metrics, and that is the only metric we are going to track for. And finally, we fit and generate our model with the training data. And there is this augmentation that we did earlier for image data generator. Since we have a lesser data set, we also flow this augmentation here. And we give the validation data to be the validation set that we have, test X and test Y. So, and we have the steps per epoch, and I just give the epochs and verbose. So finally, after our model is fit and generated, we are going to save the model to our disk. So I'll just save the model by giving model.save, and I'll just give a name called gender-detection.model. And finally, we'll use the matplotlib to track the accuracy that we have. In the model.fit generator, we save that particular history in a variable called h. And inside matplotlib, we'll say plt.plot. And this is the x values, x coordinates, and then it is the y coordinates and the label for the legends. So in the x coordinates, we'll take values from 0 to n. N is the number of epochs that we gave, which is 100. So from 0 to 100, the corresponding values of the loss of training, so which will be generated from here. So h.history of loss will give us the training loss. h.history of val loss will give the validation loss. Similarly for Veru, similarly for h.history accuracy, we'll get the training accuracy and validation accuracy. So we are going to plot all these things to have a view on how our model performed. And we give a title like training loss and accuracy, and number of epochs in the x-axis. And y-axis label will be the loss or accuracy percentage. And legends, we are going to keep it in the top right corner. This can be anywhere. So I just gave upper right. And finally, we are saving our image to our disk by simply typing plt.save fig, a name for our plot to be saved. So if you do not know much about matplotlib, I've already made a video on that. I'll leave the link in the description. Kindly have a look. Let us now run our train.py file. So in order to run this, open your terminal, and I would strongly recommend you guys to use Anaconda terminal, and I'm also using the same Anaconda terminal, just because the reason that it is easier to run, and it is comparatively very easy to install the dependencies as well. So once you open this, go to the file path where your train.py file is present, and type Python followed by the name of the file, that is train.py, and then hit enter. So it will take quite some time to complete running your model. I'll pause my video and come back once it has successfully run. The training is complete now. All the 100 epochs that we gave us successfully ran. You can see all the epochs that has run here, and by now the plot and the model is also saved in our disk. So let us take a look at the plot, like how the model went. So the model kind of looks good because we can see the training loss and the validation loss. The training loss is the red color here, red color line, which you can see in the legends. So the training loss and the validation loss both are very less, almost near to zero. And we can see both the training accuracy and the validation accuracy is quite good, almost at 99%. So you can see one here. So this is the percentage of the accuracy and loss in the y-axis that we gave. And in the x-axis, it's the number of epochs. So we gave 100 epochs, right? So it kind of gives back the results in this way. So what I feel is we just arrived at the good model. And we also have our model saved here. So let us now go to the next part. Let us now see how to apply our model into a live web camera. So these are our imports here. All the imports are pretty usual except one import, which is the CVLib. I'll say what is CVLib as we go through the code. For the first step, what we do is we are loading our model that we saved in the previous train.py file. So in order to load that, we are calling the load model from keras.models. And second thing, we need to initiate the web camera. To initiate the web camera, we use cv2.videocapture, and inside this I give 0. 0 is nothing but I'm using my primary camera. So if you have like 3 or 4 cameras, if you want to use the second camera, you need to give the second index 1. And if you want to use the third camera, you need to give the indexes 2. So, and we have two classes, man and women, which is the output of the model that we generated. So first thing what we need to do is we need to detect the frames via the web camera. So a video is nothing but a series of images over time. So that is why we say frames per second. So number of frames appearing per second is a video. And now I'll tell what the CVLib does. We generated a model that kind of recognizes whether the given face is a man or a woman, but it doesn't recognize what a face is. In order to recognize the face, we use detect face from the CVLibs module. So that is why I give cv.detectface, and the frame that is captured by the camera is sent into this as an input. So once that is given, it gives back a couple of values, the face and the confidence. So it predicts the face and the confidence. We need to loop through the face to get the x and y coordinates. So this start y, start x and start y, and end x and end y. So this particularly looks like this. For example, if this is an image, so the CVLib actually gives the starting point. So this point is actually the starting point, which is start x and start y. And similarly, the top right hand corner is the end x and end y. So this is what the output that is being generated. So once we give the start and the end coordinates, we are going to draw a rectangle using CV2. So CV2.rectangle, we are drawing a rectangle over the frame. So that is the first argument. And we are giving the start x and start y coordinates. And then we are giving the end x and end y coordinates that we got here. And we are giving the color coordinates here. So color is nothing but B, G and R. So as I said, values in images takes from 0 to 255. So in this case, both B and R are 0, but G is around 255, which means we are giving green color. So that is the color coding here. And the final 2 is nothing but the thickness of the rectangle that we are going to draw. So I gave the thickness as 2. And now that we detected the face and drawn a rectangle around it, we need to particularly crop out that face from the image, and we need to feed it into our model. So that is why we are just cropping the model with the indexes here, and we are cropping that into a particular NumPy array. So once we crop that out, we are going to resize that particular cropped image into a 96 by 96 height and width, because our model is trained on that particular dimensions. So after we crop out, we do the feature scaling as we did before. We are dividing it evenly by 255 to get the values of the images from 0 to 1. And we convert that image to array, and also we expand the dimensions. So finally, what we are going to do is we are going to use our model object that we loaded here. So with that model, we are going to call the predict function, and inside this we are going to pass in the particular face that we have cropped. So we give the index 0 here because it kind of returns a 2D matrix. So you can see two brackets here, right? So it kind of gives it back a 2D matrix. So in order to get a 1D matrix, we are just giving the index as 0. So after that, whatever the confidence is high, we are getting the particular index by using np.argmax. And with that index that we got IDX, we are passing into the classes list. So classes list, as we saw in the beginning, is nothing but man or woman. So in that, we'll be getting the maximum value, which is the label. And this label is something that we are going to display above the rectangle that we are going to surround the face with. And this is going to be a format string. The first string will take the label itself, indicating whether this is a man or woman. And the second thing that we are going to display is a confidence digit. So I've given .2f, which means it displays up to 2 decimals. So that will be the confidence here. And I'm multiplying the confidence with 100 so that we convert that decimal value into a percentage value. So we are drawing on that frame the label and the start x and start y, and we are giving the font as Hershey Simplex, and the color we are giving as green, and the thickness again is 2. And finally, we are showing the final output as CV2 imshow with the frame name as gender detection, and we are passing the frame inside that particular display. This will break out of the loop here. So while loop, it will break out. And finally, we are releasing the web camera and destroying all windows. So this is all about applying it on the webcam, which is a very easy path. Let's now see the final output. To do that, open your command prompt. I opened my Anaconda command prompt, and go to the path where your particular detect gender webcam file is present. And after going there, type Python followed by detect gender webcam.py and hit enter. So after you hit enter, it takes some time and loads the camera. Let's wait for it. Yeah, so you can see my face here. It shows man with 100% accuracy. And let me take my mobile phone with an image of a woman. And you can see it shows woman 100% accuracy. You can have a closer look, and when I show my face also, it shows man. So this is how this is what we have developed. Hope you enjoyed this video. Subscribe the channel to get more videos like this, and see you soon in another video. Bye.